the devil meant for bad, God meant for good. What the devil meant for bad, God meant for good. What the devil meant for bad, God meant for good. What the devil meant for bad, God meant for good. What the devil meant for bad, God meant for good. What the devil meant for bad, God meant for good. He thought he stole it from me. It's become a testimony. He thought he stole it from me. Devil meant for bad, God meant for good. What the devil meant for bad, God meant for good. What the devil meant for bad, God meant for good. What the devil meant for bad, God meant for good. What the devil meant for bad, God meant for good. What the devil meant for bad, God meant for good. Stole it from me. Now it's become a testimony. He thought he stole it from me. Now it's become a testimony. All my sorrows turn to dancing. All my pain turned into joy. And all my tears turned into laughter. And all my fear turned to a roar. So praise the Lord.
Something I can put my faith in. Oh, you struck a match in the dark. lab and it took time. Been chilling down in Florida, having good times. Running your race, can't get all checked. Don't got a front when you got my back. Let's go.
Oh, you're changing my altitude. Your love is a whole new mood. Something I can put my faith in. I know.
Come on, let's get ready to worship Jesus. Try.
its sound. Oh, may I then in him be found. I just need righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne.
In this song is the part that says, weak made strong in the Savior's arms. It's such a good reminder because we oftentimes think that weakness is a bad thing, that we have to have it all together all the time, and that if we show any weakness, that it means that our faith isn't strong enough, that we lack belief. But it says in 2 Corinthians 12:9, that my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is perfected in weakness. When we bring our weaknesses to Jesus, he will be our strength that we need to continue to push forward. He will be the Lord that will guide us out of any storm, any hardship, and any trial. When we bring him all of our burdens and all of our weakness, he will give us hope, rest, and peace. So let us right now surrender our weaknesses to God and ask him to be Lord over our lives. Members of our prayer team are coming up. If you are needing any kind of prayer today, regardless of it is, maybe you want to pray over those weaknesses, whatever you're going through, we're here for you. I want to invite you to come forward and connect with one of our prayer teams as we continue to sing about God's greatness in our lives. Come on, let's continue to worship one more time.
You are love, you bring light. guys sound awesome. Sing it out. Say, hey, what's up? Handshake, high five. Then be seated. Turn your attention to the screen. Awesome.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Christwalk Church, where we exist to inspire people to follow Jesus every day. My name is Ray, and I'm so glad that you've chosen to join us today. Whether you are with us in person or watching online, I just want to say thank you so much for being here. Before we go any further in our service today, there's a few things I want to make you aware of. First, if you are new to Christwalk Church, we would love for you to let us know by filling out one of the black and white Connect cards in a seat near you. In return, we'd like to give you a small gift as our way of saying thanks for being here today. Simply take your card to the green Next Steps tent at the close of service to pick up your gift. In addition, we'd love for you to consider coming to our welcome party. You'll be able to meet some of our staff and find out how you can get further involved in the life of Christwalk Church. To register for the next welcome party and to find out more about all of the events and activities taking place at the church, please visit thechristwalk.com/events or click on the Events tab in the Church Center app. And finally, as you honor the Lord today by returning His tithes and giving your offerings, you may do so in one of four ways. For starters, there are a couple of silver boxes on the back wall of the auditorium with envelopes underneath. Simply fill out the envelope, place your gift inside, and then drop the envelope in one of the boxes. You can also give digitally through our website by visiting thechristwalk.com/give, by clicking on the Give tab in the Church Center app, or by texting any amount you'd like to give to the number 84321 on your mobile device. There is a short setup process that first time, but after that, it is the quickest and easiest way to give. Today has already been a great day, and that is going to continue. So let's grab our Bibles, notebooks and pens, and get ready for today's message.
Well, good morning, Christwalk Church. How's everybody doing today? So good to see all of you. It is an incredible day here at the church. The weather is perfect. We have our spring fling going on outside after both services, and I'm excited about that. It's also a day of celebration. I am celebrating the fact that though we are 7 days removed, I have it on good authority that the tomb is still empty and Jesus is still alive, and that my name and those of us who have placed our hope and trust in him as Lord and Savior, our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And so I'm celebrating that this morning. We are celebrating together all that God did here last weekend. It was a record weekend for us over the course of our three services, Saturday night and then our two on Sunday morning. We had 352 people in attendance, which is awesome. That's 25% more than we had last year. We had over 75 of you served at two of those three services, which was just incredible. Let's give it a hand. Give a hand to our volunteers. And perhaps my favorite number of the weekend, we had five people say yes to Jesus, step out of death into life, from unbelief into faith. And so we are celebrating that this morning, people. That their lives are changed forevermore. We're celebrating today some stuff that we saw kind of for the first time last week that's continuing on today in some of the transition of our staff. The young lady that was right here leading worship this morning, Michelle Sanchez, she has just joined our staff in a part-time role as worship coordinator, and so she's going to be overseeing all of the worship, the songs, the set list, the band, and everything, which is going to give Chris Moore, who has been serving on our staff for the past 3 years as our worship and creative director. His role is now expanding. He is now our experience director, and so he is actually over everything that takes place on campus on Sunday morning, the entire experience. And so we're excited about what God is doing and how he is expanding and helping people to lean further into to their gifts and skills and abilities. And so that's worth celebrating. And I know both of them are going to absolutely crush it in those new roles. And I'm excited to see how the Lord is going to continue to develop them and where he is going to lead us and our church through their efforts. And then we're also celebrating. There's a lot of celebration going on, guys. Yeah. A lot of celebration. It's too good not to celebrate. A month ago, we had our we'd been talking about our Make Room campaign, and a month ago was actually our Commitment Sunday. So our Make Room campaign, for those of you that might be new to the church, it is to help fund a church expansion, building expansion that we are looking to do. And you can find more info about all of the details of all of that on our website at thechristwalk.com/makeroom. There's also, as you exit the auditorium on either one of the doors on the walls there, there's some graphics and some information that will point you in that direction as well. But we're looking to raise $750,000 to help offset the cost of this project, to go with the some $600,000 that we have in the bank free and clear that we've saved up. We're debt-free as a church. We're looking to take the next step. And so we have a goal of raising $750,000. So in the first month of our campaign that officially launched on March 10th, we've had 54 individuals or families make pledges to support this project financially. The total amount that has been pledged so far in 1 month, $592,804. That's 79% of our goal already pledged in the first month. I think we might have shot a little too low. I think we're going to blow that $750,000 out of the water after it's all said and done. And not only has it's one thing to make a pledge. it's an entirely different thing to begin to fulfill that pledge and actually put your money where your mouth is, so to speak. In the first month, the very first month of the campaign, you guys have already given $194,854.34. We're already 26%, we're a quarter of the way there, not just in what's been pledged, but what's already been given. And that number includes $118.45 that was given in our children's ministry that they brought. And then $225.84 given in our youth ministry. And I think Pastor Abby has to get slimed as a result of that. So I don't know when that's happening, but I want a front row seat. I want to be sure and be there. So just know that that's coming at some point. And if you have yet to be a part of that, there's still time. You can make a pledge today if you feel the Lord leading you and your family to be a part of that project and to support it financially. You can still make a pledge today. There's some information in our lobby on the wall. There's pledge cards out there. You can fill one of those out, drop it in one of the silver boxes before you leave today, and we would be honored for you to come alongside and make a pledge to be a part of that with us and help us see this dream realized. So some of you may be wondering, you know, where are we in the process? And so we're in that time period where there's a lot of stuff happening that you can't really see the fruit of. And so we're currently working with a civil engineer that is going to be here over the course of several weeks, doing some preliminary site work, taking some surveys, getting some things, collecting some data that we are going to need that is then going to funnel into our blueprinting and our permitting process as we move forward to getting a general contractor and then actually breaking ground, hopefully later this year is what we're looking at, is the hope and the plan right now. And so that's it's happening and it's going on, and there's forward motion, beneath the scenes, behind the scenes. It's kind of like a duck, you know, a duck swimming on the water. It doesn't look like much going on at the top, but underneath the surface, like the little web feet are paddling. That's kind of what's taking place right now. And so I'm excited about where God is leading us and the opportunity that he is providing us as a church. And I want to say thank you so much for your faithfulness and your generosity. You are truly making a kingdom difference here. And so can you just give yourselves a hand for everything that you're doing to help make this possible? Man, I'm pumped. I am pumped. If you've got your Bible, you got a smart device, I want to invite you to turn with me or swipe with me to the New Testament. We're going to be in the very first book of the New Testament, the first gospel, the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 14. In case you're unfamiliar, the Bible's divided into two larger sections of Scripture. You have the Old Testament at the beginning, and then you have the New Testament is that second section. And then at the beginning of the New Testament, we have the first four books, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. We refer to those as the four Gospels. We call them gospel because gospel means good news, and those four books are such good news in particular because they tell us of the life and the teachings of Jesus. And so we're going to be taking a look at one of those passages here in just a moment, Matthew 14, and we'll pick up in verse 22 here in just a second. But before we do that, I got to know, have anybody in the house, have you ever found yourself in the middle of a storm? Anybody in the middle of a storm? You know, here in Florida, we are certainly no strangers to storms. It probably a couple months from now, we'll all be huddled around the TV with our family, watching a bunch of colored noodles and wondering, where's it going to end up? You know, and then it's going to cut to the guy who's out in the wind, and he's in like full rain gear, and he's like pushing against it, and he's like, I'm right here in the middle. And then there's always that couple like walking their dog in the background, like, it really ain't that bad, dude. You don't have to, you know, they're chill. But that's going to be us here in a couple. But I'm talking this morning, I'm talking about something way, way more than just hurricanes. Maybe some of you would say, you know, Pastor Blake, if I'm being honest, I'm in a storm right now as we speak. Or there's a good chance that if you're not in a storm today, that unfortunately, to be the bearer of bad news, there's probably one that is on its way. We are no stranger to storms. Maybe it's a health issue, like a sickness or a broken bone. Maybe you have to have surgery, or you've just had surgery and are trying to recover. Maybe the doctor has given you some kind of diagnosis that does not look very good. Maybe it's a job issue. Perhaps today your storm is the stress of losing a job, or maybe it's the stress of getting a new job, or maybe it's just the stress of having a job in general. Maybe that's your storm today. Maybe it's a relationship issue. Your marriage is on the rocks. There's a rift between you and extended family. Maybe you have a rebellious or prodigal child in your home. Maybe there's a friend that let you down. Maybe your storm this morning is a money issue, perhaps an unexpected bill that came in the mail, or loss of hours at work resulting in less pay, or rising costs due to inflation. And your storm is simply that there's not enough money to make it through the month. Maybe it's something else altogether, but regardless, those things are very present. They are very real in our lives. We are no strangers to storms. And in the middle of those kinds of experiences, we can often be filled with doubt. We begin to ask questions like, why is this happening? Why is this happening to me? And why is this happening now? When I think about that, I think of a project, maybe you've heard of it, the Biosphere 2. Anybody ever, are you familiar with the Biosphere 2? It's a live-in terrarium project out in Arizona. It's actually considered to be a widespread failure. It was an incredibly expensive venture that did not fully bring about what they had hoped. But these scientists, they built this thing in Arizona, and these scientists were going to go in, they were going to live in it and do all of these tests. And inside of this biosphere, they could create all of these different climate scenarios and everything. They could have, like, deserts and rainforests and all of this stuff, so that they could, in these perfect and pristine conditions, they could recreate all of these different things so that they would be able to study them and immerse themselves inside of these different atmospheres and everything. And one of the crazy things that they discovered when they got inside of the Biosphere 2 and they started to do their work is they noticed that trees inside of the biosphere were growing rapidly. They were growing much faster inside the biosphere than they were outside of the biosphere. But then they discovered something that eventually, before those trees would reach full maturity inside of the biosphere, they kept falling over. And they tried again and again and again, and they would plant other trees and they would grow fast, but before they would reach full maturity, every single time they would fall over, and the scientists, they were left scratching their heads. They could not get to the bottom of what was going on, and they did all kinds of tests and all kinds of studies and everything until they finally figured it out. There was something that the biosphere lacked that the real world had to offer. There was something that despite all of the things they tried to create inside of that dome, there was something that they could not accurately generate. There was one thing that was missing, and inside of that dome, there was no wind. And as a result of there being no wind in each of those tree species, there was a lack of what is known as stress wood. It's literally called, that is the scientific name for it. It is called stress wood. And stress wood it's more dense and stronger than normal wood. And it's concentrated primarily at the base of trees to stabilize them against the wind and the weather. And the more severe the wind is, the greater proportion of stress wood that would appear in the tree. And so what we see is that as we walk through this life, we see two things, two truths. Wind is inevitable. We are going to face the wind. The other truth that we see is that wind is also necessary. It's necessary to produce the fullness and the maturity in us that we need in order to be and to accomplish the things that God is wanting to bring about, that he's wanting to do in our lives. And so this morning, we're going to take a look at a passage from Scripture where there were some people caught up in the midst of a storm. And out of that truth, or out of that passage, we're going to look at five truths that a storm reveals to us about Jesus. Five truths that a storm reveals to us about Jesus. Number one, if you're taking notes, write these down. Jesus sends us into the storm. Jesus sends us into the storm. I know that that doesn't sound true. I know that that's a little bit off-putting for me to start there, but just trust me. Picking up Matthew 14, beginning in verse 22, listen to what it says. It says, immediately after this, Jesus has just fed the 5,000. Maybe some of you are familiar with that miracle. He's just fed the 5,000 with a little boy's lunch of five loaves and two fish. It says, immediately after this, Jesus insisted, watch, that his disciples get back into the boat and cross to the other side of the lake while he sent the people home. And after sending them home, he went up into the hills by himself to pray. And night fell while he was there alone. And meanwhile, the disciples were in trouble far away from land, for a strong wind had arisen, and they were fighting heavy waves. Jesus insisted. He did not give them an option. He said, you need to get in the boat, and you need to get back out there on the water. And it was when they were doing what Jesus had told them to do that they found themselves in the middle of this storm. Now, really, there's primarily two kinds of storms that you and I will face in our life. The first one of those is storms of discipline. That's not what's taking place here. When we think of storms of discipline, we want to look to someone like the life of Jonah, who Jonah disobeyed God. He tried to run in the opposite direction of where God had commanded him to go. Jonah's storm was God's way of course correcting the direction of his life. And sometimes God will allow us to experience the consequences of certain poor decisions that we make in order to help us get our lives back on track. And those are storms of discipline. They're correcting us, getting us moving in a different direction. But that's not the storm that's taking place here. The storm that's taking place here is not a storm of discipline. It is a storm of development. See, there is a word for anyone who told you that following Jesus and doing what he told you to do was going to be all sunshine and rainbows. There's a word for that. That word is liar. If someone has ever told you that, they are a liar. See, Jesus never called us to live a life of ease and comfort. He called us to take up our cross and to follow him. And there was a church that I was a part of at one point, and this always tickled me, but there was a man there, and part of his ministry, he felt like the Lord had called him just to show other people what it looked like to take up their cross and follow Jesus. And so literally during our Sunday school hour on Sunday mornings, he would get out a physical cross, throw it over his shoulder, and he would kind of walk up and down the side of the road outside of the church as a display for people. But the reason that it always kind of made me giggle is that at the base of his cross, he had attached two little wheels. And so he would put that cross up over his shoulder, and he would just kind of roll it down the road. See, try as we might, we can never shortcut the difficulty of following Jesus. So you need to hear your pastor this morning. The cross is heavy. It has splinters and nails. The cross will cost you blood and sweat and tears. The cross, sometimes you may have to drag it through the mud. The cross, there's going to be times where you're going to topple over beneath its weight. But yet Jesus tells us that this is the way that we discover his peace, is by taking up our cross and following after him. See, Jesus knew that the time was quickly approaching when he would no longer be physically present with his disciples. They were going to be thrust into a whirlwind of political unrest and religious upheaval in their quest to spread the gospel and to establish the church. And so rather than coddling them and protecting them from all sorts of adverse situations, Jesus instead thrust them into the middle of those situations to teach them and help them to gain the necessary experience that they were going to need later on. He talked about this in John 16, 33. He said, "I have told you all of this so that you may have peace in me." He says, Jesus says this, "Here on earth, you will have many trials and sorrows." Mark it down. Take it to the bank. It's going to happen. You will have them. Not you might have them. You may have them. No, you will have many trials and sorrows. But he says, "But take heart, because I have overcome the world." When we choose to follow Jesus, we're going to face some stuff. We're going to get ourselves into some things. It's not like the pathway in front of us is not just going to clear wide open, like all of the obstacles just dissolve and get out of the way. There is going to be some difficulty. There's going to be some adversity when we choose to follow Jesus, because it puts us going in the opposite direction that the rest of the world is taking. But I will make you two guarantees when it comes to following Jesus. Two guarantees. Number one, it won't always be easy. Number two, it will always be worth it. Those are two guarantees I can make you today. It simply boils down to our outlook and our mindset. James, the brother of Jesus, writes about this in his book, James chapter 1, verses 2 and 4. He says, "Dear brothers and sisters, when troubles of any kind come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy." Now, it doesn't say that you will naturally be joy-filled when obstacles come your way, but it is an opportunity for you to exercise your own joy. He says, "For the reason you can be joyful is because, for you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow, for when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing." There may be times that you face a storm of discipline, but that is not always the case. Sometimes the Lord is not doing something to you. Sometimes he's trying to do something in you by allowing you to experience those things. And growth always requires some type of adversity. When we are little bitty babies learning to walk, we have to fall on our backside a few times before we eventually figure out how to maintain our balance. When we are in school and we're amassing amounts of knowledge, it requires that first we get some answers wrong before we eventually are able to get them right. When you're trying to build muscular strength, it requires us to push against our limits, to break down the muscle so that it will build back stronger and stronger and stronger over time. It's what the great theologian Kelly Clarkson meant when she said, "What doesn't kill you makes you stronger." So if you are in the middle of a storm today, I want you to change the question that you're asking. A lot of us, when we find ourselves in the middle of the storm, the question that we ask is, "How can I get out of this?" The question we need to be asking when we find ourselves in the middle of a storm is, "What can I get out of this?" There's a big difference there. Jesus sends us into the storm. Number two, Jesus shows up in the storm. He shows up in the storm. Picking up in verse 25 of Matthew 14, it says, "About 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came toward them walking on the water. And when the disciples saw him walking on the water, they were terrified. In their fear, they cried out, 'It's a ghost!' But Jesus spoke to them at once. 'Don't be afraid,' he said. 'Take courage. I am here.'" See, in that moment, They were so overwhelmed by the storm, by the waves, by the wind, by the fighting that they were having to do, that they saw this figure walking on the water and they couldn't even believe that it was really Jesus. They were unable to see him for who he was. They thought it was just a figment of their imagination. And perhaps the greatest lie of the enemy that he wants you to believe is that you are all alone in the middle of whatever it is you're facing. This passage tells us that not only is Jesus there, but he came to encourage you. He says, don't be afraid. Take courage. I am here. It's what the writer of Isaiah, it's what he was talking about in Isaiah 43 verse 2. He says, when, there it is again, not if, but when you go through deep waters, I will be with you. When you go through rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you walk through the fire of oppression, you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you. Somebody today, you just need to hear. You just need to know that you are not alone in your situation. You have not been overlooked. You have not been forgotten. I came to tell somebody this morning that just like he was with the three Hebrew boys in the fiery furnace, just like he was there on the battlefield as David faced Goliath, just like he is standing upon the waves in the midst of his disciples' terror and fury, he is there in the middle of your storm with you today. He will send us into the storm, but he will also show up in the storm so that we do not have to face it alone. Number three, Jesus summons us in the storm. He summons us into the storm. Picking up in verse 28 of Matthew 14, it says, then Peter called to him, Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you walking on the water. Yes, come, Jesus said. So Peter went over the side of the boat and walked on the water toward Jesus. It's an interesting thing. Peter says, if it's really you. I'm always perplexed by this. Despite what he saw, he still couldn't believe his eyes. Who else would it be? Like, how many people do you know that would be able to do something like this? There's only one. What do you mean, if? Like, you got people walking on the water all around? Like, what in the world? If it's you. He wanted to know. He wanted to make certain. See, there's doubt there, though. Despite what he is seeing with his own eyes, that's what the storm does. The storm causes us to see things from a different perspective. But often, the storm is the only way that God can get our attention. Because as long as everything is smooth sailing, we rarely realize our need for the Lord. But when there's adversity, when there's difficulty, when there's something that causes us to be a little bit afraid, then it gets our attention. And so Peter, he says, Lord, if it's you, have me to come out. And in this moment, as Jesus is calling him out onto these waves, I can't help but think of when my kids were little and they were scared to jump in the pool. You know, and I'd be in there and I'd be like, come on, you can do it. I've got you. Daddy's here. I'm going to catch you. And what happened is as soon as they mustered up the courage to take that leap for the first time, what happened is that something that they were once fearful of now turned into something that was fun. Something that they were cautioned towards now became something they were confident in. All because I was there to catch them and help them to see there is nothing to be afraid of. You can be confident this morning because the thing that has you worried is what Jesus is walking on. He's not trying to figure it out. He's standing on top of it today. Jesus sends us into the storm. He shows up in the storm. He summons us in the storm. Number four, Jesus saves us from the storm. He saves us from the storm. Picking up in verse 30, it says, but when he saw the strong wind and the waves, speaking of Peter, he was terrified and began to sink. Save me, Lord, he shouted. And Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him. You have so little faith, Jesus said. Why did you doubt me? What an incredible question. We'll come back to that in a moment. You remember, I don't know if you did this. I did weird stuff as a kid. I'm 42. I'll be 43 this year. I still do weird stuff. But have you ever done the thing where, like, you put, like, a hand over one eye? And, you know, like, I can see all of you out here if I'm looking at you with my left eye. But then if I close my left eye, all I can see is my hand with my right eye, you know. And you're looking at two things at one time. You know what I'm talking about? You're looking at two things at one time. And then, like, as a kid, I would sit there and I would, like, I'm closing and, like, doing all of this so that, like, to make it go back and forth. I told you I'm weird. You did it too. Don't lie. See, when we do that, our brain will not allow us to focus on two things simultaneously. And so when you do that, when you hold up a hand in front of one eye, it actually looks like you're looking through your hand, but you can't see things quite clearly. There's an obstacle in the way, and that's what doubt does. Doubt literally means to have a divided mind because we are unable to focus on two things at once. That's what's taking place here. That's why Peter began to sink, because his mind was divided. He was trying to focus on Jesus and focus on the wind and the waves and everything else going on. And that's why he began to sink, because you can't focus on two things at one time. And James tells us that there's danger in that. In James chapter 1, we talked about another part of it. Later on in the chapter, in verse 6, it says, be sure that your faith is in God alone. It's talking about being undivided. Be sure that your faith is in God alone. Do not waver, for a person with divided loyalty is as unsettled as a wave of the sea that is blown and tossed by the wind. Such people should not expect to receive anything from the Lord, for their loyalty is divided between God and the world, and they are unstable in everything they do. The Bible says that as long as we doubt, we're going to be unstable, because we can't focus on two things at one time. As long as we're trying to focus on Jesus and also keep an eye on our problem over here, we're going to be unstable. That's why we've got to focus on Jesus, and we let him keep an eye on the problem. That will make us stable. See, if he isn't worried, we shouldn't be worried. But the good news for us this morning is that when we miss the mark, he is right there to rescue us. And that his salvation is immediate. I'm going to hold off. Maybe he'll learn his lesson this time. No, as soon as we call on the Lord, he is right there. If you find yourself sinking in the midst of your storm today, call on him now. And the guarantee is that he will hear you and he will answer you. He's not going to leave you hanging. I'm reminded of the words of the prophet in Joel 2, verse 32. It says, but everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. That is a promise and a guarantee. That word, everyone, in the original language of Hebrew, you know what it means? It means everyone. Now, what it doesn't mean, it says, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. What it doesn't mean is that the storm is not necessarily going to come to a screeching halt. But though our situation may not change, our perspective will. See, in the moment that Jesus reached down to pull Peter up out of the water, the storm didn't cease. It was still going on around them. The situation didn't change, but the object of Peter's focus is what changed. He was focused. He was locked back in on Jesus. And it's a reminder to us that what we see in front of us is only temporary. And that for those of us that have placed our hope and trust in Jesus, that we are living for something more. And it's this idea that come what may, even if the storm takes me out, I will be better off for it. Because I can stand on the promises of the words of Paul that for to live is Christ, but to die is gain. Yeah. Basically, what he was saying there is that because of Jesus, the best is yet to come. Don't tempt me with a good time in heaven. Jesus sends us into the storm. Jesus shows up in the storm. He summons us in the storm. He saves us from the storm. Number five, Jesus is sovereign over the storm. He is sovereign over the storm. Verses 32 and 33, it says, when they climbed back into the boat, the wind stopped. Then the disciples worshiped him. You really are the Son of God, they exclaimed. Here's why storms are so important. Is that because it's in the middle of the storm that we are able to see Jesus for who he really is. He's the one who is unwavered. He's the one who is not sweating. He's the one who is not chewing his fingernails into the quick trying to figure out a solution. He is cool, he is calm, and he is collected. The disciples, before this moment, they had another encounter with Jesus in the midst of a storm. They were in the boat together. The wind came up. The water was coming over the sides of the boat, and they're freaking out, screaming, terrified. They think they're going to drown. They look for Jesus. What's he doing? He's sleeping in the boat. Mark chapter 4 records it and says that when Jesus woke up, he rebuked the wind and said to the waves, "Silence, be still." Suddenly the wind stopped, and there was a great calm. And then he asked them, "Why are you afraid? Do you still have no faith?" The disciples were absolutely terrified. "Who is this man?" they asked each other. "Even the wind and the waves obey him." See, in that encounter, they were wondering, "Who is this man?" In this encounter in the storm, they knew for certain. All the doubt had been removed, that he was the Son of God. And so when we find ourselves in the midst of a storm, we need to realize that that storm can bring greater revelation and clarity to who God is and what he wants to do in our lives. Jesus will send us into the storm. He will show up in the storm. He will summon us in the storm. He will save us from the storm, and he is sovereign over the storm. In closing, let's circle back. Verse 31. Powerful question. Powerful question there in the passage. Jesus looks at Peter and says, "Why did you doubt me? Why did you doubt me?" For the longest time, I read this. And in my mind, I kind of pictured Jesus going, like he's scolding Peter. "Why did you doubt me, you moron? I'm standing on these waves. Can't you see? Why did you doubt me? You sunk. You failed. You missed the mark." And then I realized that's not Jesus. That's not a picture of who Jesus is. So what if that question, "Why did you doubt me?" What if that's not an accusation? But rather, what if it's an invitation instead? In other words, "Peter, why did you doubt? You don't have to doubt. You can trust me. Just have faith. Just keep your eyes focused on me. Peter, don't you see? I'm standing on what you are sinking in. You don't have to doubt because I am here with you." Why? Why, Peter, are you doubting? I want something. I have something so much better for you if you'll simply have faith in me. See, doubt is not the enemy of our faith. Instead, doubt is an invitation to exercise our faith. Yeah. Doubt is not the enemy of our faith. doubt, whenever we feel that coming on, it is an invitation for us to exercise our faith in the truth of God's word and who we know him to be. And so this week, our action step is whenever we're faced with doubt, let's choose to respond in faith. Whenever those storms come our way, whenever things start to get rocky and the boat starts to shake and the wind and the waves appear, instead of us responding in fear and anxiety and doubt, and instead let's respond in faith, because we know that Jesus is developing something in us. We know that he's right there with us. We know that in a moment's notice that he can reach down and save us. We know that he's trying to teach us something in this moment. And we know that ultimately he is completely 100% in control. Why did you doubt? Just have faith. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I pray that right now, Lord, that faith would rise up in this room. Lord, as your people face the various storms that come against them, Lord, that they would be able to see things with a greater perspective, realizing that you want to develop something in them so that they will not fall over before they reach maturity, but that you will make them perfect and complete through experiencing this adversity. Help them to remember and to realize that they are not alone in the midst of their storms, but that you are there with them, calling them to lean in to you. You're not worried. You're not trying to figure it out. You've already made a way. You've already provided a solution. That you are in control over every single aspect of their lives. Lord, I pray that today, Lord, that you would help them to lean into your salvation, and that in their moment of need, that they would call on you for rescue. And then according to the power and the principle of your word, Lord, that you would be right there and that you would save them. Lord, I thank you for the faith that is being built in this moment. I thank you for the new perspectives that are coming about. And Lord, I pray that you would strengthen each and every one of us, that as doubt rears its ugly head and as the winds start to blow in our lives and the foundation beneath us becomes unsettled, Lord, that in those moments that we would exercise our faith. That we would lean fully into you, and that we would grow as a result, becoming mature and complete, lacking nothing. Give you the glory, the honor, the power, and the praise, Lord, and we thank you for what your word has to teach us. It's in the mighty name of Jesus that we pray these things. Everyone said, amen. Let's stand together. Prepare our hearts to worship through song as the band leads.
Come on, let's sing out. And I will make room for you to do whatever you want. Do whatever you want.
Making room is not just about making room for the good, the easy, the comfortable things. It's also about making room for these storms of development that the Lord wants to bring our way so that he can produce something new and different in us. Amen? So as we make room, let's be mindful of that. How God wants to move in our life, and that it may be through us facing a little bit of adversity, but knowing that we will never be alone in the middle of that. I want to thank you guys so much for joining us in worship today. You picked an incredible day to be here because the party is just getting started. So let me give you a couple just notes, some things that I need to make you aware of before we get out of here, and then some instructions about what's next. First, if you have recently accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, or you've done that in the past, but you have yet to go public with your faith through water baptism, we're going to be having baptisms as part of our service on April 28th. And so we would love for you, if you have yet to do that, to go public with your faith through water baptism. You can find out the information for that, where to register, and all of the details on our website, thechristwalk.com/events, or also by clicking on the events tab at the bottom of the Church Center app. And so we would love for you to take that step. If you have any questions about what that entails, I'll be around. Feel free to grab me, find another one of our staff members. They'd be able to answer questions and point you in the right direction for what to do and what all of that is about. The second thing is, if you're new to Christwalk, we have our welcome party that's going to take place after both services next week. We would love for you to come and be a part of that, kind of find out a 30,000-foot view of what the next steps are for you and your family to get further connected in to the life and the happenings of our church. You get a chance to meet our staff. It's going to be a great time. And so that's next week. You can find those details out on our website, on the events page, or on the Church Center app as well. And then for today's festivities, we've got food trucks, inflatables, other games, everything outside. We're going to keep the party going all day long. And the best part is, it is free. And you guys know my philosophy: if it's free, it's for me. And so we'll just let you adopt that as well. On your way out, In order to get access to the food trucks, you'll need to pick up a ticket for either of the food trucks and then also for the Kona ice truck. You'll pick that up at the green Next Steps tent, and then you'll be able to exchange that ticket for your food. We've got Hot Dog House, we've got Jack's Taco, and then Kona Ice, and so you'll be able to exchange it for your food and for your Kona Ice later. And then y'all stick around, hang out, let's have some fun, and let's celebrate all that God is doing. Make some new friends, build some connections. It's going to be a great time. Before we get out of here, come on, let's say it together. I believe that because of Jesus, the best is yet to come. Love you guys. I'll see you outside in a minute.
Dreams gonna come to life, lights are shining bright.